Steve, tell us about how you booked Dumb and Dumber 2.
That was interesting. Rick Montgomery, the casting director, months before my audition, called me in to his office on a sort of a bogus commercial. It was a real commercial he was casting, but he didn't really want to see me for the commercial. He wanted to just get me in the room and ask me if I would be willing to come out and play with these guys that were making Dumb and Dumber 2, T-O. And I said, yeah, of course, I would love to do that. He said, okay, well, we got a couple of things to iron out. And at that time, Warner Brothers was still attached as the producing studio. And I didn't hear anything for a few weeks or a month. And then all of a sudden, big news in the trades was Warner Brothers dumps Dumb and Dumber 2. And there were a number of reasons that they used as their excuse why they didn't want to be attached to the project anymore. And I just thought at that point that it's dead. And, you know, story of my life. You know, I get this close to something amazing and it blows up. But then, pretty soon after that, Universal jumped in and snapped up the project in conjunction with Red Granite, which has picked up and distributed lots of smaller, interesting films that a lot of other bigger studios didn't really have any interest in. For example, The Wolf of Wall Street is one of those films. And so Red Granite and Universal became involved with Dumb and Dumber 2, and now we're back on again. And the audition was scheduled, and I was ready with the material, and I was excited about it, and I went in, and I was expecting, I knew that the directors were going to be there, Peter and Bobby Farrelly, but I was expecting sort of a normal audition scene, scenario, just a small room with a few people in it and a video camera, and we do our thing and I leave. Well, I walked into the room and it was a screening room in an office building and with theater style seating. And there were 25 or 30 people smattered throughout the seats and these big floodlights shining down on me and a video camera there and Pete and Bobby Farrelly sitting in the front row. And it kind of threw me a little bit. It just wasn't the audition situation that I was used to. And so we chatted for a little while. I'm not a big audition chatter. I don't like to do that. I like to get on with the material and do my work and then leave the room quickly. But they wanted to chat. And they said, oh, Steve, we're so happy to have you here. We feel like we know you, we see you and everything. And tell us a little bit about yourself. Oh, I'm thinking, oh, really? So I told them a little bit about myself. And where are you from? Oh, I'm from Denver, Colorado. I grew up in Denver, Colorado. Oh, really? You a fan of the Broncos? Oh, no, I don't want to talk about sports. I really don't. But we did, and we talked about the Broncos and how they were going to do this year. And I said, the Super Bowl all the way. I just had no idea that they were going to perform so poorly at the Super Bowl. But and then we started the audition. And I had the first line in the audition, so said my line. And the guy reading with me came back with a line that wasn't on the page. And I looked down to make sure it wasn't on the page, and it wasn't there. And I said, are you sure you have the most recent revision of the script? And by that, I mean you don't. So can you get that? Now my momentum is kind of thrown off and we have to pause and wait while he goes to get the correct version, the updated version of the sides. And then he came back and we proceeded and there were some other technical problems that forced us to start over again. And the situation is just deteriorating rapidly. And finally, I completed the scene. Actually, we did two scenes. I completed the scene and I said, thank you very much, guys. Have a great shoot. And thanks for having me in. And I left. I was fuming. Smoke could have been coming out of my ears. I was so mad because I was the crash test dummy. All these things had gone wrong that I had no control over. I couldn't control any of these things. And I felt it was the worst audition of my life. And I was the crash test dummy for the other guys waiting outside who were going to go in, and those things wouldn't happen to them. because they would have all been corrected by the time they came into the room. And I knew that I did not have this job. I knew it. And then a couple of weeks later, didn't hear anything. Finally, the phone rings, and my agent told me that I am the director's first choice. Well, you could have knocked me over with a feather. I just couldn't believe it. And she said, don't get too anxious, don't get too excited, because there are still some hoops we have to jump through. You have to be approved by the producers, and then at another level by the studio. And once we get over those hurdles, then we can start to breathe a little bit. But you're Pete and Bobby Farrelly's first choice. And I thought, well, go figure. And there's an old saying, and I keep on trying to remind myself of this every day, and sometimes I forget, like in this instance. The saying is, you cannot feel your own handshake, meaning that basically I am in no way capable of evaluating how other people see me. I just can't do it. You know, would that we could see ourselves as others see us. And while we were shooting, we had a setup break, and I asked Pete Farrelly, why was I cast in this thing? I thought it was the worst audition of my life. He said, you know, you were the first guy into the room, and it's very, very rare that we ever cast the first guy that comes into the room. He didn't remember when he had ever done that. But the reason he cast me was because there was one line that I was supposed to be delivering to my adopted daughter that I delivered in a very sweet, patient, loving way, and everybody else who came into the room was annoyed with her and angry with her, and that's not what they wanted. They wanted to see that relationship of total unconditional love and acceptance under any circumstance, and that's the choice that I made, and that's what got me the role.
That phrase again, what was it?
You can't feel your own handshake.
When did you hear that? That's a fascinating...
You know, I don't remember the first time I heard that, but I loved it when I heard it. It just rung a bell with me.
So even when you see yourself on camera, you only see the Steve Tom that you know.
Well,
you
exactly. Right? And I think that's true with everybody, no matter what their job on a film or a television show is. When I see myself... that's why I don't go to dailies, because I only look at myself, and there's a whole frame of information there that I'm not seeing because I'm laser focused on me. And I think wardrobe people look only at the wardrobe, and the hairdressers look only at the hair, and the makeup people look only at the makeup. And I'm not one of those people who can see that entire frame of information in its totality. So that's one reason I don't like to go to dailies.
So going back to your rehearsal prep for this role, how much time did you have before you actually met this large room of people? When you got the sides, like how much time did you have to prepare?
About a week,
I
recall. Yeah. And I only got a few pages of information. I didn't see the entire script until after I was actually booked on the film. And I treated it like any other audition. You know, without the context of an entire script, you just have to make assumptions and make choices based on those assumptions, and that's what I did, and luckily I made the right one on that one line.
So what would your advice be to other actors who may be the first one in, or maybe they're not the first one in, but they run into all these things that are like these roadblocks, and it's frustrating, you know, and you have someone reading with you that's, you know, doesn't have the right updated sides, things like that. What's your... Obviously, it worked for you.
Well, you know, you just can't get all flustered in the room. You know, I was thinking about how furious I was while it was happening, but you can't let them see you sweat. You know, so you have no choice but to just go with the situation, and that's what I did. And I think that. That doesn't happen very often. For me, that was a rare occurrence, because usually you're in, you do your work, you're out, and it's, you know, just uneventful usually most of the time auditions are. But you have to go in with a strong choice and commit to it and stick to it. And I think that that's a mistake that a lot of newer actors make, especially when you don't get to audition very often. And that is to attach an importance to the audition that is way out of proportion to its actual importance. You're an actor, of course, but that's not all you are. And you can't let this moment in an audition room define who you are. You're a son, a daughter, a sister, a brother, a father, a mother, a friend, a mentor, whatever you are, you're all those things. So be those things once you leave that room too. I don't know if I answered your question.
Yeah, you did. That's great. Did you always think like that? I mean, it's
no.
Great.
No. Uh-huh. No, not at all. I mean, when I was brand new, every audition was nerve-wracking. It was so important that I get this job. So important. And I noticed after a while that what I was doing was sort of dumbing my own audition down. I was sort of making myself so bland and playing it so safe in the audition room in hopes of getting that job that I was taking away every bit of my uniqueness and quirkiness and weirdness and vulnerability and everything that makes me castable. The one thing I would tell actors is don't do that. You know, let yourself be. Don't be afraid to fail monumentally in an audition room. Don't be afraid. And go in with that choice that you've made. And if you fail, you fail. There'll be more where that came from. There will. But give yourself the opportunity to be that quirky, crazy, wonderful, psychotic, weird person, vulnerable person that will ultimately make you castable.
When did that change for you?
Took about a year and a half, 2 years. Yeah, I'm not a fast learner.
Well, I think some people, they never learn. I mean, it's almost like dating. I know I've said this before, but when someone's taken, you know, then all of a sudden they're very attractive to the opposite sex or same sex or whomever.
Yeah.
But then, because you don't need it as badly. So then,
Where
did you get to that point where you realize, I still want to do this, this is why I'm here in LA, but I don't know, I'm assuming you still wanted it as badly, but you realized I'm more than just this actor coming in to read. I'm a human being. I'm a lover of birds, lover of different things.
I'm a fly fisherman.
Right.
I love the outdoors. I love all kinds of things other than this.
Mm-hmm.
And I think to be a well-rounded actor, you have to be a well-rounded person too. And so kids, stay in school. I joke about that, but truly, live your life. Live life. Travel. Meet interesting people. Go to interesting places. Do unusual things that will expand your horizons as a human being. And along the way, you'll turn into an interesting person. Yeah, and I think that's really important. And I've always sort of tried to do that, and I think it's helped.
How many days were you on set for Dumb and Dumber 2?
On set? I was there for almost a month in Atlanta. I think I worked about 12 days out of that. So there was a lot of time to have fun and enjoy Atlanta too, which was just great. I enjoyed it. But yeah, about 12 days of actually being on set, working.
And your character is?
My character is, I'm not going to tell you his name, because everything that you're seeing now, as far as his name goes, and my wife's name goes, and my daughter's name goes, is, I will tell you, it's a diversion. It's not our real family name. And you'll find out why once the film actually is released, why that name is being withheld.
Okay.
What did you ask me?
Let's go back. That's fine. So you're 12 days in Hotlanta. What were you doing, you know, like to prepare on set? I realize it's a fun city to be in, and you were probably taking in life. But what were you doing to prepare while you're there? Are you in a trailer the entire time, rehearsing lines? Are you watching other people to kind of get a feel for the pace of the production?
I wanted to, when I first got there, they took me directly from the airport to wardrobe. and I had several wardrobe changes during the course of working on the film. So we wanted to get that all squared away. And then I went back to the hotel and checked in, and I called for transpo to see if somebody could take me back out to the set, because I wanted to get, I'd never seen Pete and Bobby work. I wanted to get a sense of the tone and the pacing of what they were doing, and to, most importantly, meet all the people on the crew whose job it is to make me look good. Those are the first people I want to make friends with. On any set, TV, film, or the crew. I think those are really important relationships, because if you irritate those people, they can very easily make you look very bad too. Yeah, with lighting that's not quite right, or camera angles that aren't the most flattering in the world, and a lot of people don't understand or realize that those relationships are really, really important, and so I wanted to meet the crew, and what a great crew it was, and that was my first bit of preparation that I actually did in town before I worked, and then you know, I had done much of the character preparation, and there wasn't a lot involved. A lot of my prep involved specific plot points that I cannot tell you about at this point. But it wasn't terribly extensive, and it was kind of an easy role to fall into. Once we were actually there on set and they called action, just kind of jumped in and threw myself into the maelstrom of activity, and with Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels and the rest of our amazing cast, Rob Riggle, and my wife Lori Holden from Walking Dead, Rachel Melvin, who played my daughter Penny. And I got to spend a day locked in a hospital broom closet with Kathleen Turner, having sex, simulated sex, in a broom closet. It was one of the best days of my life. She's a thoroughbred. There isn't a better actor out there than Kathleen Turner, I think. Yeah, it was fun. So you just kind of throw yourself into it and have fun. That's all you can do.
So from looking at your IMDb page, you've appeared in roughly 87 projects or so.
Is it that many?
I believe so. Jeez. Yeah. We'll check with my intern back. No, I'm kidding. That's us. So no. But do you still need to audition? I mean, obviously, you've been called in for Dumb and Dumber 2, but that's still just a normal part of what you do?
Yeah, auditioning is... That hasn't gone away yet. Offers are being made a little bit more often now that I have a little bit of name recognition and face recognition, and people have worked with me a time or two. And that's what's so important about relationships. I just can't stress enough how important it is to cultivate relationships. This is going to sound terrible. I know I'm not the only one, though. I used to use criteria for whether or not I would want to work on a project just based on the importance of the project, or its visibility, or the paycheck. If the paycheck wasn't enough, then I wasn't interested. And you know, those days are over. Those times have changed. It is much more, and maybe it always was, much more about relationships and forming relationships. And the people that you're going to work with today, you will also be working with tomorrow and the next day and the next year and 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the line as well. And it's important to cultivate those relationships, because it's like planting a seed. It sounds silly, but that seed will germinate and grow and turn into other wonderful things down the line, 9 times out of 10.
Well, you said that you didn't always think like that. So can you tell me a story when there was a turning point? I find that interesting.
No, I can't remember the exact turning point. Well, yeah, there was something that hit me kind of hard. At an audition, there was a very, very well-known actor there who was auditioning for he was a former series regular, and he was auditioning for a guest star on this show, same part that I was reading for. And I just asked him in the room, I am so surprised that you're even sitting here with the rest of us and auditioning for this role. And he said, you know what? Doesn't matter anymore. Doesn't matter anymore. It's all about the relationships. And if I can form a new relationship with a person or a group of people by coming into the audition room and meeting them that way, that's what I'm going to do. And I thought, wow, I never thought of it that way. I never thought of it that way. And it's true. It's true. Also, delivery platforms have changed now. And things that I wouldn't have considered doing 5, 6, 7 years ago, like webisodes, now, yeah, if you have a cool webisode that is interesting and has an interesting cast and crew attached, I'm there. You bet, because the delivery platform is irrelevant now. It's the number of eyeballs, and you can get the number, the same number of eyeballs on television that you, or on YouTube or on the internet as you can get on television now. Well, I mean, for the very, very new actor, somebody said something to me once that insulted me. I was insulted by it, but the more I thought about it, the more truth there was to it, and that was, you know, take the cotton out of your ears and stick it in your mouth. Watch. Learn. Don't be talking about, you know, don't try to make yourself out to be more than you are or try to impress anybody. Just be right-sized. I don't know if that makes any sense. You don't have to be bigger than you are. You don't have to be deferential to anybody. You don't have to be smaller than you are. Just be right-sized, but just be a watcher and an observer and learn how things work. And it's like any other business or endeavor that you become involved in. You have to learn how to do it. And along with learning how to do things technically in this business and creatively, you also have to learn how to diplomatically approach situations that come up from time to time. And it's just all part of the game. But the secret of being able to do that is lasting long enough to be able to do that. And for me, it's been getting in line and not giving up my place in line for anybody or anything. And because I forget what the statistic is, but every year there's some huge number of actors that have been here for a year or two and then they are not here anymore. They vanish. They're called sundowners. They'll stick around for a year and they'll give it a shot and then they'll just give up. And the attrition rate is very large in this business. So get in line, stay in line, and don't give up your place in line, because people in front of you and in back of you are going to, particularly in front of you, are going to give up. They're going to decide to get married. They're going to go open a restaurant. They're going to, you know, for whatever reason, decide to go in another direction and give this up. So you very quietly just step forward, take their place in line, and with any luck and persistence and talent, where are you going to wind up? Close to the front of the line. And, you know, I'm not at the front of the line yet. I kind of like it where I am right now. But it sure beats where I used to be at the end of the line. You just have to stick with it. Be persistent. And you'll be okay. Even if it doesn't work out, you'll be okay. Everything's gonna be fine.
Sundowner. That's fascinating. Have you known any sundowners?
Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Sure. There were people that I worked with years ago that were amazing actors, and they're not here anymore. If I told you their names, you'd say, who? Never heard of them. But they were absolutely awesome. But they decided to move in another direction.
Is that because it was too frustrating?
I don't know.
Just numerous reasons.
Could have been any reason. But they're not here, and I'm still here. Am I the most talented actor in the world? Oh my God, no. No. I mean, I have my little niche. I do what I do. I still have tons to learn, but I stuck around and they didn't. And I'm here, and I'm so grateful for that.
So keeping with the theme of the sundowner, which I love this terminology, how often have you seen other actors that you deem more talented than yourself turn around and quit, go somewhere new? And what does that do to you inside?
Well, I've seen it happen. I don't know the exact number of people that have decided to move on and not stay in the business. But when somebody leaves, and sometimes you don't know they're gone until you just don't see them for a while and you're reminded that they're not here. What it makes me feel is, better than me. This is what I signed up for. This is what I want to do. This is what I've wanted to do since I was a little boy. I love to tell stories. I love to have the opportunity to perhaps get somebody to see something in a way that they didn't think about looking at something before, or feel something that previously they have not felt, or look at something in a way that they just hadn't occurred to them to look at something, and maybe it'll help change the world in some tiny, tiny, tiny way. And I think that's a great calling. I do, and that's why I'm here. So for those that leave, God bless them, and they had their reasons, and I don't know what those reasons were, but they don't concern me. And I just step up and take their place in line and try to make them proud, if we were friends, and try to make everybody else proud that I'm working with, that we've had this opportunity together, and maybe we can do something special with the opportunity.
Have you ever talked to anybody metaphorically down from the ledge, where they're thinking of giving up, and you've just given them the same piece of information that you've given us?
I don't know. I certainly didn't know it at the time. There was one woman that, a long time after it happened, thanked me privately for, spending some time and talking with her and kind of talking her down. I mean, she just had it. I remember the long conversation we had on the telephone about, why this business sucked and there was no opportunity for advancement for her and nothing was working and she just felt like she was on a hamster wheel going nowhere. And I said, that may be true and it may not be true. You may never go anywhere, but you're not going to find out unless you stay and try, because it could happen tomorrow. Could happen tomorrow. That's what happened to me. I mean, I was just kind of a workaday co-star, occasional guest star guy until I was brought in to audition for an HBO show on a Saturday. Ugh, Saturday? That's very inconvenient for me. I really don't want to go in and audition on a Saturday because I play softball on Saturdays and maybe they'll do it a different day. Agent, can you get me in a different day? No, they're just doing it on Saturdays. All right. And I went in and there were 50 other guys there and they all looked like me. And I thought, oh, geez, this is ridiculous. But I did my job in the room and then I came back and I came back again and the herd thinned and thinned and thinned and thinned. And finally, make a long story short, I was cast as Ed Halligan in Funny or Die Presents, and Liz Paulson brought me in for that role. And that show, produced by Will Ferrell, which was sort of the TV version of the Funny or Die website, changed everything for me. It put me on radars that I previously had not been on, and opened a lot of doors for me and created opportunities that I never would have had Liz not brought me in for that role. And I will forever be grateful to her for that. Yeah. But and to just to finish the thought, if you don't stay and wait for that opportunity, you won't know. So that woman and I had a very long conversation that night, but I was just trying to give her a pep talk, but it turned out that it was important to her, and she stayed, and she's still here and working.
So when did you realize how much of a choice it was staying here, in terms of like, hey, it may not work out, but it may, but this is the choice that I've made, and I'm going to stick with it even if it doesn't work out, and know that I spent many years.
Well, there's another ingredient of that, which is much more ethereal and not ethereal, but it's harder to really get a grasp on, I think, and that is a sense of self-awareness. You have to also know when it's time to hang it up. I don't know how you quantify that. I don't know how you measure that. Maybe for me, it's just been, I've been too dumb to think that this isn't an option for me. That's not what I meant. Maybe it's that I've always felt that I have some innate talent in this area. Not as talented as other people, but I do have my own set of skills that I bring to the table, and I think they're worth something, and I'm going to stick around, and somebody's going to appreciate them one day. And that's turned out to be true. But, you know, for some folks, that's not true. And they'll probably never be they'll never achieve the kind of success that they think that they should be achieving in this business. And, you know, maybe it is time to hang it up at some point. But how do you tell, you know, when that time is? I don't know.
Do you ever do the test of, well, if I'd rather be selling annuities, I'd be doing it. Or if I'd rather, you know, if there was something else that really called to me, I'd probably be doing it. Or is that a bad measurement of staying around?
I've always wanted to be a fly fishing guide, and sometimes that's been stronger than the call to stay in, you know, the performing business. I wouldn't be able to make a living doing that, and it's silly. I mean, it's a romantic sort of notion to, you know, be out on the river catching trout all day, and but this is what I love. This is what I love. I don't know if I answered your question at all.
Oh, you did, yeah.
What we've been talking about, how to know if it's time to quit or give up, this has been so uncomfortable for me, this just talking about it. I don't know why, but it's very, very uncomfortable, because I can't possibly tell anybody else when that time is. It's something that has to just come from, you know, the inside, and some place that I just don't have access to, in your spirit. And it's difficult for me to even talk about it. I don't know why. Isn't that weird?
Oh, it's a very. I mean, there's people that have achieved amazing success, and you see, obviously, it wasn't enough, because through self-destruction or whatever, they're no longer here. So no one can, yeah, it's a very, you know, and everyone, some people are just happy being a working actor that's, you know, what's the film that we talk about? The guy in that thing, and it's this great movie about, this documentary about just actors that just work all the time, and they're recognized, but people don't know their name, and they're very happy with that. So, you know, without all of the baggage that fame brings with them. So it's a very, the people have different levels of what they want.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
And it is uncomfortable, you know, to talk. I think for a lot of people, even for you know, and we'll take
In other words, I only know what's right for me.
Sure.
And what what the right and wrong choices for me have been along my career path. And I guess the discomfort comes from presuming to have any sort of wise words to tell anybody else about how to tell when it may be time to stop, or it may be time to just dig in even harder and hang around. I don't know. Only that person can make that decision.
So hearing that voice that says whatever, and you can go to therapy for years and you can identify who that voice was, and you can find, oh, it was the third grade teacher and she used to tell me this all the time and I still hear her now. Whatever, we can all rationalize who that might be, but when you're in that moment, and let's suppose you don't have another amazing actor who's confiding in you, how would you advise, or maybe you can only tell your own process, and that's fine, to get rid of that voice? Because I think everybody hears it, whatever, just stepping out the front door to go to the grocery store, you know, we can all hear it.
It's, there's no magic pill, except to just take contrary action. Take an action that's contrary to what you're hearing in your head, or to what you might be feeling. Because what I was feeling there, you know, with being, you know, I'm afraid they're going to find out that I'm a fraud and they're going to fire me, and none of that had any relation to reality. That's just my own self-doubt. And it's not real. It has no relationship to reality whatsoever. And so you have to just then put one foot in front of the other and continue moving forward in a positive way, taking actions that are contrary to those feelings, directly contrary to those feelings. You know, if you're feeling self-doubt, act with confidence. And that's how I get through it. Then it still happens. It still happens, but that's exactly how I get through it. I was in a mini-series a couple of weeks ago, that ended a couple of weeks ago on IFC, another Will Ferrell project called The Spoils of Babylon. And my scenes were with Val Kilmer. We played a couple of army generals, and we were doing some green screen work in an old car driving down a road after we had just killed someone. And the director, Matt Piedmont, said, all right, now, in this take, I want you guys to pull over to the side of the road, and Steve, I want you to tell Val that you've fallen in love with him. Okay, but Matt was my director on Funny or Die Presents, and I got to know him pretty well, and I really trust him, and even though I thought, well, this is a little odd, okay, we're going to go for it. And you know what? We just went for it. Val and I both just went for it. And it was one of those things where you just had to fully commit to it and make a decision to do it. And so that's what we did. And we had quite a torrid love scene in the front seat of that car, most of which did not make it into the miniseries, but we committed to it, and we went for it. There weren't any tongues, but yeah. And so, yeah, I mean, the point is, you have to commit and act as if that's not what you're feeling, and take that contrary action. If you're feeling self-doubt or apprehension or fear, the only way through it is through it. But you have to move forward through it.
What have you observed as some of the mistakes you see other comedic actors making in terms of timing, really overacting, you know, from what you've seen?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind is something that I used to do all the time. And it was to, if I was either auditioning or having booked the job and going in to work on a sitcom, for example, with one line, two lines, three lines, is to try to milk all the funny that I can out of those lines and try to be a funny cast member. And the truth is, the funny lines are given to the regular cast, the series regulars. they're the funny ones. We're here to support them and to be the straight man and to, you know, just participate in the telling of that 22-minute story. And that it's not about me. It's not the Steve Tom show. It's not all about me. I'm just there to enhance the performance of the series regulars. And I think that mistake, I made that mistake constantly for a while, but somehow I was still able to book work. And but you know, eventually you just learn, you know, and it's through repetition and through failing sometimes and making mistakes. But that's a big one. That's a big one. In fact, that's the biggest one that I can think of. Yeah. And I also think it's important for actors to know the difference between approaching a multi-camera sitcom and a single-camera sitcom, because the techniques are different. And so they should Google multi-camera and single-camera and read about those and learn the difference between the two. And that will really serve them well, I think, in the long run.
Can you share any tips on that?
Single cam versus multicam?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
In a single camera sitcom, very tightly edited performances are more possible. And retakes are really sort of a necessity in that area. And it's sort of a much more subtle performance, I think. In a multicam situation, those sitcoms are, I would say, most of the time filmed in front of a live studio audience. And so it's a little bit of a more theatrical performance, as if you're doing a play, because you have an audience there. The timing is different. You have to wait for the laugh from the audience. And you don't necessarily do that in a single cam sitcom. So there are these subtle differences, and every actor should know the difference between those two techniques and learn them. Yeah.
So going back to what you said before that you thought was so crucial, it's almost like an extra who's overacting in a scene when you're really supposed to be in the background. So similar for some of the smaller comedic parts, let the big players be the wavy characters.
Yeah.
And you're the straight person.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It's not the Steve Tom show. Yeah. And you know, I wasn't approaching it in that way because I thought it was the Steve Tom show. I wanted to be, it was a sitcom. I wanted to be funny. And sometimes you just don't have to be. You just attach more importance to it than contextually it actually has in the teleplay.
Right.
Just be your character. You don't have to be the star of the show.
If you were given the opportunity to sit with a group of brand new actors, let's suppose it's a round table, and they asked your advice on casting directors, what would you tell them? And this is the Steve Tom show. This is your forum.
Oh, wow.
And people are hanging on your every word.
In what sense? In what?
Well, suppose you've been asked to come to a college or something and lecture, and they want to know everything there is to know about casting directors. What should you say? How should you approach it? Should you bring them flowers?
Oh,
beer?
Okay. All that stuff. First of all, ditch the perfume and the cologne. Luckily, years ago that happened, because casting directors were complaining because people were bathing in perfume and cologne and coming into the room and after, you know, a bunch of people paraded in and out, it was just overwhelming, and a lot of people have allergies to that. So that's the first thing. Don't, you know, just take a shower with soap and don't put anything on after that. It's much nicer for everybody involved. What else? Sending a gift to a casting director after you've booked something. Oh, wow. I generally don't do that. I'll pick up the phone or drop by the office, if that's an office where I can do that and we have that kind of relationship, and thank them and let them know how grateful I am for the opportunity that that they gave me by casting me in this project, and it was wonderful, and I had the time of my life. I'll do that. I have given gifts to casting directors, just because in my mind the opportunity that I had because of them was so monumental and career changing that I think it was, it just deserved more than a cordial thank you. But their job is to shine for the production company. They want to bring in the best actors they possibly can. And when they've done that and everything goes smoothly and the director and the crew and the production company and the studio are so happy with the way things turned out on the shoot, that, you know, that's a great reward for a casting office, for everybody in the casting office. And everybody does their job, and I don't think we all have to, you know, constantly thank one another for it. And I think that, you know, sort of falls into the area of trying too hard. Again, they know who you are. They bring you in because they know who you are and they want to see you. You don't have to thank them for it. That's their job. And I don't mean to say that casting should be thankless. There's a great documentary that was released a couple of months ago called Casting By. Did you happen to see it? Yeah, it's wonderful. That focused on a particular casting director and her efforts to have that part of the film process or the television process recognized by the awards shows. Anyway, I'm kind of going a little far afield there. It's a wonderful documentary. If you ever have a chance to see Casting By, don't miss it. It's wonderful. It'll give you a whole new perspective on that particular part of the industry. What else? Do's and don'ts for casting directors. That's kind of what we're talking about here.
Yeah. Etiquette when you walk in the room. How conversational should you be?
Okay. This is my personal etiquette. I don't reach out and shake hands with. I don't touch anybody unless they offer first. People are petri dishes, and I don't really want to touch them, and I don't think they want to touch me. But if somebody extends their hand to me, certainly I'll extend mine back. Props. Don't bring props into an audition. It just, it's sort of desperate, and you don't need them. Everybody has an imagination, and they can use them, and you don't need to do that. Don't ever touch a casting director as part of a scene. If you're supposed to be strangling someone, they're not the person you want to actually put your hands around their neck. Don't do that. Feedback. Do you want to harangue your agent about feedback? Can you call the casting office and please get feedback? Please, I want to hear feedback on my audition. How did I do? How did I do? The feedback is whether or not you book the job. And that is not necessarily negative feedback. The thing that the most valuable thing that ever happened to me in this business was being able to sit in on a casting session on their side of the room to see what happened. It was actually a commercial casting session for a client that I have now, an ongoing client that I have now. 99.9% of the time, the decision not to hire an actor has nothing to do with the actor. Nothing, particularly in commercials. It has to do with issues of diversity. It has to do with height or color of hair, mixing and matching different actors to achieve the goal of the client that must be served. I mean, those things must be served before anything else. These decisions don't have anything to do with the actor necessarily. Most of the time, they don't have anything to do with it and should never be taken personally, ever. It's hard to understand that unless you do get that opportunity to sit in on a casting session on the casting director's side and to hear the conversations. after the actors have left the room to hear what they actually talk about. It's not them. It's not me. It's something else. So, you know, just go in the room and bring it. Just bring it. Bring your A game. And leave quickly. Leave quickly.
Why?
I would much rather. There have been times when I've stayed in the room a little bit too long and been a little too chatty, and I thought, well, you know, the longer I stay in here, the more they're going to get to know who the real me is, and they're not going to be able to resist me. And that, no, I would much rather have them want me to come back in the room. I want to leave them wanting a little bit more. So I go in, I do my work, I say thank you, and I leave quickly. And I close the door behind me. And if they want me to come back before I'm in the car, they'll come and get me. That actually happened once. I was auditioning for a crime drama set in New York. I won't tell you which one. And it was the audition was like two or three days after 9/11. And I walked in the room and I was introduced, and somebody said, "How you doing?" And I said, "Well, I picked a hell of a time to quit smoking." And you could have heard a pin drop. Just crickets. And somebody, I don't know who it was, but one of the producers or somebody in the room, this was a producer session, somebody said, "Who the hell do you think you are? Don't you know what happened 2 days ago?" And I looked up and I said, "Hold it. Who said that? Which one of you said that?" And nobody would admit to it. I said, "You know what? Screw you all. Because everybody is dealing with this horrific thing in the best way they knew how. And, you know, I chose to put a light touch on it when I came in the room here. And how dare you get on your high horse and tell anybody else how they should feel about this? You know, have a great shoot. Screw you." I didn't say screw you, but I walked out the door. I said, "F you." And I walked out the door. Walked out the door. Didn't read. I was furious. And before I got to my car, somebody came running after me and told me to come back. And I went back in the room and they said, "You know what? That's kind of what we're looking for in this character, and we'd like to offer you the job." That's what happened. I don't recommend that as a rule. In fact, I don't recommend it at all. But it was just one of those things that happened to work at the time. And
without naming names, have you ever worked with a bad director?
A bad director. No, I really haven't. I mean, there have been directors that whose vision of the project and take on my particular character didn't necessarily jive with what I showed up with to work with. Again, it's, I think you have to be willing to just be part of the process. You know, if I'm a $17 million A-list guy, then I feel like I have more of an opportunity to say, "You know what? No, this is the way I think this role should be played, and your take on it is hogwash. Forget it." Well, I can't say that. I'll go with what the director wants me to do. And sometimes you feel like, "Oh, this is going to be the worst thing in the world, and it's going to ruin everything that I wanted to bring to this role, and it's not going to be what I thought it would be." You have to do it. You have to suck it up and be willing to take direction And that's just the way it is. It did happen once on a show. And this was more of a technical direction that turned out badly than anything else. The star, I was in a room full of people, and I had to deliver a line to the star of the show down at the far end of a table. We were sitting at a long table, and he was down at the end. And I just, you know, I said the line. And I saw him, the star, motion to the director, and the director came over, and he whispered something in the director's ear, and the director said, "Steve, can you say the line a little louder, please?" Well, yeah, sure, I'll do that. So we did it again, and the same thing kind of happened. And I generally got the idea that the guy at the end of the table, the star, couldn't hear me. He was having trouble hearing me. And so we did the take two or three times, and every time I was asked to speak a little louder so he could pick up his cue from me, because he couldn't hear me. And the take that they finally used on the show, when I watched it, was me screaming this line to the actor at the end of the table, and it was ridiculous. It made me sound ridiculous, and it kind of ruined the scene, in my opinion. But he heard me, and he got his cue, and the scene continued, and that was that. And was I happy with it? No, but I wasn't, you know, in a position where I could really fight for it or do anything else. I mean, the guy couldn't hear me. What are you going to do? Is that?
What about an inexperienced director? Maybe great person, you know, very friendly tone on set, but you can tell maybe they're a little indecisive or something. Again, same rule applies. I mean, you said you didn't feel like you had the license to say something.
Well, I mean, at that point in my career, this was just a co-star on a wildly popular show, and I was just kind of a day player, and I didn't feel like I could say anything. I think if it's an inexperienced director, I might at this point in my career be willing to go off to the side with him and say, I'm thinking that it might be interesting to try it this way, and here's why I think that, and da 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 da, and I, you know, I'm not sure what you're trying to accomplish with your direction, and I'm certainly willing to try that, but I'd like you to maybe entertain the option of trying it another way when we're finished doing what you would like us to do. Sure, yeah. I don't see anything wrong with that.
In your view, how important is it for the director to be a leader on set? And if so, what are some of the verbal cues, nonverbal cues, that they are the leader? How do you feel like you can trust them to be led?
Well, that's a really good question that I've never really sat and thought about before. I think it's important for there to be somebody in charge on the set because, you know, there are actors are strange creatures. They have egos and opinions. And I remember one movie that I shot a few years ago where the director and the star were constantly fighting publicly in front of the rest of the cast, screaming at each other, "I want you to do it this way. No, I'm not going to do it this way. That's bullshit. I'm not going to play the character this way." And I mean, it made the rest of us, we were, you know, just waiting to shoot something, and they would be having these screaming arguments with each other in front of everybody. And it sort of makes you feel uncomfortable and takes away your focus from what you're there to concentrate on and delivering the kind of performance you want to, a real authentic performance. It was not a happy set. And I will say that in this case, I believe that the actor who had the problem shouldn't have signed on to the project. This is not the first time, I'm guessing, that he was made aware of how the director wanted him to play this role. I mean, don't sign on to a project if you're if you and the director aren't on the same page and have the same general vision, I don't think. So I don't know where this came from, but it was a very uncomfortable experience. And yes, I think there has to be a leader, and the director's the guy that that does that, in my opinion. I've also been on shoots where things were a sort of chaotic and maybe morale wasn't the best, and another actor stepped up and sort of brought the cast together and gave them a pep talk and, you know, let's get through this thing, we can do this. It may not be gone with the wind, but we're gonna, you know, hold our heads high and give the best performances we can and walk out of here feeling good about what we did. And that's happened a couple of times too, where the director really wasn't the one in charge and things were rapidly falling apart, but another actor stepped up and pulled it together. So yes, I do think that it's important that there be a chain of command and somebody at the top to make decisions and rally the troops and motivate people and inspire people and give especially the actors a play, and I hate this word sometimes, it sounds so warm and fuzzy, give them a safe place to do what actors do. That's important. And some directors just won't let actors be actors. They won't let them do what they do. They want a particular, some directors are technical directors. They know what they want technically, but they're not the best at communicating to actors in a language that actors can understand and then translate into a performance. Other actors are actors direct, or other directors are actors directors who can speak that language and aren't afraid to let the actors do what they do and take those risks and maybe try things that are a little bit off the beaten path and experiment.
So that's what gives the feeling of a safe set in some ways, you think? When that director is just more willing to give leeway, it's not so based on the script and there's just more room for sort of trying things differently?
I like that environment. I kind of prefer that. It's a symbiotic relationship and there's a lot of trust involved. The director has to trust the actors that they know what to do, and the actors have to trust the vision of the director as well. Most of the time, it's a very happy collaboration, but sometimes it derails a little bit one way or the other, but most of the time gets back on track again. Usually it works out well.
Sure. Well, anytime you're dealing with a large group of people, there's sort of a mob mentality, you know?
Yeah.
And one bad thing could send it one way or the other. And so how have you seen an actor, or excuse me, a director steer the ship back? Let's suppose some things happen, weather issues, whatever, technical problems, and the morale's bad, it's late at night. Without naming names, have you seen somebody steer it in the right course, and or maybe just by saying it's a wrap for the day? And
just then, away from the rocks that we're imminently going to crash into
and
turn the project into a disaster? No, I've never been on one of those.
Okay.
Luckily, no, I never have. Some days are not as good as others, and I think you're right. You have to make a decision to just wrap for the day. Mm-hmm. Let everybody go have a cocktail or have a good dinner or a great night's sleep, and tomorrow's another day, you know? And I've seen things turn around after a good night's sleep, yeah, that were headed for imminent disaster before the director called, let's wrap for the day. Yeah.
When you're performing and you're not in front of a live audience, how do you know that your character's working? How do you know that you're having an effect, whether it's comedic, dramatic?
Sometimes you don't. Sometimes you just don't. I've seen the final product on television or in a theater sometimes, and I'm thinking, ooh, they didn't laugh there where they were supposed to, where we thought they would. or it just didn't have the emotional impact that that we thought it would have. Most of the time, you can tell. You're depending on the chemistry you have with the other actors, and if it's authentic and it's real, you just know that. You can. It's an organic feeling that is just so present there that you just know it. You know it, but sometimes you don't. You can't hit a home run every time, and even though the business expects you to, sometimes you just don't. So do you cry yourself to sleep and quit the business? No, you just get back up on the horse and try it again the next time.
Were you ever one of those actors that could not watch themselves on screen, that would have to leave during the premiere?
Oh, no. I love to watch myself.
Okay,
I just don't like to watch myself during dailies because I don't think I'm the best judge of how that whole frame of information is working, because I can only see one tiny part of it myself. I like to see myself.
You're able to see, because you know we talked about it before, you only see yourself as you and all your years on the planet, and you know yourself and ins and outs. What about people that can't watch themselves? Is that again, that's their choice? Don't you think that maybe they're harming themselves by not seeing who they are?
Well, am I happy with every performance that I give and the way I look on screen every time I see myself? No, I'm not. Either the camera angle was not flattering sometimes, or the makeup was a little too troweled on and doesn't look that great, or who knows, any variety of things, mostly technical. And sometimes I've just given performances that I, that felt good at the time, but then when I finally see them, just didn't quite hit the note that I wanted them to hit, and I think every actor goes through that. But you asked me, what do you do? Just you just get over it. Get over it. It's not that big a deal.
Right.
You know? And again, you can't feel your own handshake. It's not, there's a lot of other stuff involved in that scene or that entire project that doesn't have to do with you. So it's not that big a deal.
In terms of us not being able to see how maybe the rest of the world sees us, do you think it's important to get feedback from casting directors or, do some of these workshops where people kind of find your type so you can know, maybe you think you're one type and they see you as something else. They see you more as an army general or, a banker or something like
well,
that.
Well, I do.
You're a cowboy.
I do a lot of judges and governors, lawyers, stuff like that.
Did you always see yourself as that type? Maybe you thought you were a fly fisherman.
No, I thought of myself as a romantic lead for at one time. But I think one of the most important things an actor can do is to have that self-awareness. An actor needs to know what his type is and what his brand is, his or her brand and type. I can't emphasize how important that's been for me. And it guides me in decisions that my agent has in submitting me for things as well. Sometimes I'll say, no, please don't submit me for this because, I think you'd be terrific for this. No, trust me. This is not in my wheelhouse. Not that I have to, be safe in every project. I think it's also tremendously important to push the envelope and try things that I'm not confident with and that are scary for me. That scene that Val Kilmer and I had in the front seat of the car was an example of that.
Were you always self-aware? They always say that that's the mark of a very successful person. Whatever industry is self-awareness. That's one of the main things.
Well, you know, you watch the American Idol auditions and you see people who have zero self-awareness. They cannot hear themselves sing. They think they sound like Pavarotti, and they sound like a screeching cat instead, and there's no self-awareness there. I don't know how you, I mean, it's either a blessing to go through life that way or a curse. I don't know which one it is.
If you think well of yourself, I guess it's probably a blessing.
But. Yeah. But I think for actors, we do have to have a certain sense of self-awareness that I think the more developed it is, the better it serves us.
Yeah. Are there exercises in self-awareness? Because what if someone, maybe they grew up with blinders on and now they're in this big city and it's a whole new experience, and all their life they were, oh, you're this dear, and patted on the head and coddled, and then they come here and it's a whole rude awakening.
Well, I mean, reality is a cruel mistress sometimes, and sometimes, you just have to be slapped in the face with the truth sometimes. And if you're constantly going out and auditioning for one thing, and nobody is casting you, I mean, nobody is ever offering you roles of the type that you think you should be playing, and they're constantly offering you roles of a type that you don't think you should be playing. I mean, come on, get a clue. Clue phone's ringing, it's for you. Maybe you ought to consider this other type that you've been repudiating up until this point.
Aside from that, I mean, that's a great, you know, analogy of that, but are there other ways to develop your self-awareness? Maybe just through youth, you just think, it'll all turn out and it's all going to be great.
I never did this, but somebody suggested this to me once in a class, and I think it's a good idea. Set up have a couple of pictures of yourself on a card table, and set up the card table at a mall or someplace like that where you maybe get away with something like that. And just as people pass by, ask them what job do they think what your occupation is. Just by looking at the pictures, what occupation does this person have? And write down the responses. And generally speaking, they'll all fall into one or two or three different categories, and they'll all be kind of similar. And that's a good way to see yourself as others see you.
Interesting.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. I never did it, and I kind of wish I had done it, but I don't think it would have changed anything, because I do know what I look like and what my strong points are, I think, if I have any.
What's the longest time you've gone between auditions?
Oh, wow. Months. Months.
How is that for you?
It's demoralizing. It's demoralizing. It's hard to keep up your enthusiasm and your... joie de vivre about what you're doing. When you're only getting into the rooms maybe once every one or two or three months. And I don't know if there's a way around that other than to not let that define who you are as a person. I mean, if you're not auditioning and your reaction to that is to just stay at home and turn on old TV shows and, you know, cry about not auditioning, you know, I don't think that really serves to help the situation at all. And I used to do that, of course. You're an actor. You want to be acting. You want to be given the opportunity to act. And if you're not getting those things, it's depressing and discouraging. Instead, though, I mean, and I still go through those periods where there are, you know, feast and famine times. And when things aren't as fast as they have been in the past, you know, I go out and do something I enjoy. I find some other thing to occupy my mind. One of the best things to do is to go help somebody else. Because when I'm thinking about somebody else and helping them, what am I not thinking about? Myself and my own problems. So I really strongly recommend that, in addition to, you know, whatever interests outside of acting that you have, throw in some sort of volunteer work. I can't tell you how much that's benefited me and gotten me out of my own head sometimes, which is the worst place to be sometimes, just the worst. And those times will pass. They always have. They always will. Of course, you always think with every job that it's the last job you'll ever have, you'll never work again. And the truth is, I've been doing this a long time, and I have been provided for by the universe through all of it. And there's no reason to think that that won't continue to happen for as long as it's supposed to happen. So I'm content with that. And if things are a little slow, I'll just go off and do something else that I enjoy.
Aside from fly fishing and things like that, was there ever a time when you set out to do something different with your life? Or did you know that you wanted to be in this industry for a very long time?
I always wanted to be an actor. Always. From the time I was a little boy. But that's not what I went to school to do, or the business that I originally got into when I left school. I was in the broadcast news business, doing radio and television news. I started in Chicago and moved around the country to a bunch of different cities and wound up in San Diego working at a news talk radio station as morning news anchor. And I also had kind of a little side voiceover career there as well. And I'm a ventriloquist, and I can imitate airplanes flying over too, while I'm speaking at the same time. I heard about a television movie that was shooting in San Diego. They were looking for some guy to play a detective. I thought, I could probably do that. Look like a detective. And I went to my agent, my voiceover agent, and I said, can you please get me an audition for this TV movie? And she said, no. No? What do you mean no? She said, you're a voiceover person. You're not an actor. Oh, well, don't ever say that to a voiceover person, because I don't think there's a more elevated form of acting than voiceover, because you only have your voice. I keep touching your microphone, I'm sorry. You only have your voice. You only have one way to create this great texture of a performance. Anyway, she said no, she wouldn't send me to the audition. I begged her and I begged her and I begged her, and she finally said, oh, God, all right, I'll send you to the audition, but if you don't book this, don't ever ask me again. And I said, okay. And so I went and I booked the role of this detective in this silly, back in the days when they used to call them movies of the week. And it was my very first job on television. I got to work with Linda Gray and Linda Pearl and Kent McCord, who I just saw yesterday over at my voiceover agent's office. I love Kent. And Ernie Lively, who was my detective partner. Ernie's such a great actor. And I was, you know, terrified. It was my first time ever on a television set, and it was awful. It was nerve-wracking and horrible, and I think my performance was just awful. It was horrific. But then I went to audition for another one, and I booked that one, and another one, and I booked that one. And finally, I thought, well, if I want to play the game, I'm going to have to really live where the game is being played. So I moved from San Diego to Los Angeles and haven't looked back since then. Of course, I had to have a day job for the first couple of years.
What did you do?
Oh, wow. I sold Lincoln automobiles, Santa Monica Lincoln Mercury. I worked as a maintenance guy at a marina in Marina Del Rey at an apartment complex in Marina, where I was constantly having to unplug drains that some of the tenants would pour candle wax down, not knowing, apparently, or being smart enough to realize that you don't pour candle wax down your drains. I sold shoes. That was horrific. You know, you do what you have to do to put food on the table and meet your obligations. So,
what about the voiceover work? Did that continue once you got to LA? Because now you're even more immersed in the industry.
I was doing a fair amount of voiceover work until about 5 years ago, when it sort of started to drop off a little bit, only because I became much, much busier on camera and wasn't able to get to auditions. But that has sort of now changed, because the technology of being able to audition from wherever you are on your smartphone and having it sound comparatively really good has all changed, and you're able to do that now. So the voiceover stuff is picking back up again. Another thing I think is important is to know how to do more than one thing. You don't have to be a master of all trades, but be a jack of a few. Voiceover stuff, on-camera stuff. I happen to be an expert in a very peculiar skill called an ear prompter. It's a little wireless receiver you wear in your ear, and you record pages and pages and pages of script onto a micro cassette recorder, and you wear a little transmitter around your neck. And so you turn it on and you just follow what you're hearing. You repeat what you're hearing, two or three or four words behind what you're hearing, and you don't have to memorize anything. You can go pages and pages and pages of stuff. So I do that. In fact, that's how I did Funny or Die Presents. We shot 13 episodes of this show in one day. And the only way, because they couldn't afford a teleprompter, so the only way, you couldn't memorize that volume of material. So I put it on my ear prompter, and we got through 13 shows in one day, and they loved me. Yeah. So learn how to do more than one thing. I think that's important too.
And the voiceover work, if someone wanted to get started in that, I mean, what's the best way to do that, especially if they've never done it before?
Well, voiceover is without a doubt the most competitive niche, I think, in the entertainment business. There are so many different facets to it. There are, there are commercial voiceovers, video games, just all kinds of different components to the world of voiceover, animation, the world of voiceover. The most important thing I think a new person can do is to take a class and learn how to do voiceover. Doing voiceover is not about having a voice like this 99% of the time. It's about, and the flavor of the day changes constantly. And you have to be adaptable to that and go with that. And you have to be able to take direction and learn how to say a phrase in 99 shades of blue. And being able to interpret copy is so important. And you learn all that in a voiceover class. And there are a number of different good ones that are being offered in Los Angeles at any given time. And something you might find that it's not for you. But give the class a shot to find out whether or not this is something you really want to pursue. And then make yourself a demo CD. And there are people that produce demo CDs as well. A mistake that a lot of new voiceover people make is to move too quickly into making a demo, because demo producers can produce something that sounds really professional and slick. The problem is that if you don't have the classroom experience and the sort of semi-real world experience of working constantly in a group situation in a class, then you won't be able to live up to that demo in a real world studio situation. And you're not going to do anybody any favors by doing that. So, everything occurs in a specific order. and spend as much time as you need to on each ingredient in the order there. And you make a demo, and then you shop your demo around to agents. And voiceover isn't really a hobby. It's not a part-time thing. You really sort of have to commit to it as a full-time endeavor if you really want to have access to the auditions and to the opportunities that come with voiceover. Yeah, it's daunting. It's daunting, but the rewards are great.
What about acting? Can that be a part-time thing? I know a few people that have told me, you know, I love to act, but it's so difficult that I just don't want to keep going out on these auditions. So if I can do a couple things a year, I'm totally fine.
You know, if it depends on what your level of comfort is. If that's okay, and you don't have to, putting food on your table and paying your rent doesn't have to depend on acting, then sure, you can treat it as a hobby. You can do theater, you can sort of pick and choose what's available at that level, at the hobby level. You have to remember again that this is Los Angeles, and it's I like to think it's still the center of the entertainment business. There's a lot of competition here. If you're thinking of acting, believe me, there are people that have been doing it far longer than you have and that have resumes as long as your arm, who may be 12 years old. So that's what you're faced with. That's the kind of competition you're faced with here. But again, if you want to pursue it as a vocation, as an occupation, then you're going to have to do it full time. Yep. And you just jump in. You just jump in and you develop that resume and you develop the kind of presence that is attractive to casting offices and to agents to get yourself some representation. And sure, it's open to everybody, and there are the stories of overnight successes, but I don't know of anybody who has been one of those.
Sure. Lana Turner in the coffee shop.
Yeah. But there's something with actors that pulls us into this. It's not that we want to do this necessarily. Was this a choice that I would have made? Not really. From the time I was a kid, I just wanted to tell stories. I loved to tell stories, and I wanted to express myself in that way, and I had to do it. It was much more of a situation of feeling as if I had to do it or I would explode than making a conscious choice to do it, which I don't, knowing what I know about how difficult it is, I don't think I ever would have made that choice. But I had to. I had to, and here we are.